So our next task is to look at Lebesgue outer measure and Lebesgue measure. We won't be able to do all of the details because, well, it's a significant portion of a 50-credit module to do this properly. But I'll give you enough of the definitions so you can see how it works, and then if you want to go and read up any of the missing details, they're all available in books or from my measured integration notes, which are available online as well. So what is it we want to do? I told you what the Lebesgue measure is about. It's about generalizing length, area, volume, making it formal, seeing how many sets you can measure the size of, and what good properties you can get. And it turns out there are problems. I'm not going to go into this in great detail, but for example, there's the Banach-Tarski paradox, which says that if you take one solid ball in R cubed, you can chop it up into five pieces, sufficiently complicated, that just by translating them and rotating them around and putting them back together, you can get two complete copies of the original ball back again, with no loss of any volume or anything in the final version. Now, this sounds impossible, but it's a very good trick if you've got a ball of gold, because all you have to do is chop it up into these complicated pieces, put them back together, and you've got two exact copies of your ball of gold that you started with. And what's the only problem? The pieces you chop them up into must not be Lebesgue measurable, which means they have to be sufficiently horrible that you can't do it in the real world. You can't do it without it. It's such a shame, otherwise you could be rich, right? And there's another version of the paradox which says that if you take a ball the size of a pea and chop it up into finitely many pieces, a lot more than five, you can put the pieces back together after translation and rotation to get a ball the size of the sun. In fact, far more is true. Okay, so this seems like a paradox, and it would be a paradox if the pieces you chopped into had a volume, because volume doesn't change when you put things back together and take them apart and rotate them and translate. But the only reason this paradox, apparent paradox, works is the pieces you chop up into are so complicated that you can't actually give them a volume. There's no way to make sense of volume for them. And that's why there's no paradox. The original set you had had a volume, and the final, much bigger set you have had a volume, but the sets in between didn't. And that's why there's no paradox, and that's what results the paradox. Well, we're not going to be covering that, though it's an optional project one could do. But it does show that you've got to be careful when you say, well, why do we have to fuss about what area or volume is? Why don't we just say, we know what area and volume are and work with it? And the answer is because some sets are so complicated that you really don't know what area or volume they have. We're going to work in one dimension, but the construction we're going to talk about is going to be a pretty general one that you can use in any dimension you like. We're going to be working with a construction based on length of intervals. If you want to do the two-dimensional version, you work with areas of rectangles. There's no dispute around. People agree what the area of a rectangle is, and people agree what the volume of a cuboid in three dimensions is. And that's your starting point, and the same for length of intervals. That's your starting point, and from there you have to build up your notion of the measure of as many sets as possible, but you can't quite do it in a satisfactory way for everything. I will give you a measure of size for everything, but that measure doesn't quite add up right, as we're going to see in the next section when we look at a non-measurable set. So we won't actually do the Carathéodory extension theorem, but that's what's hiding behind all this. In the middle of one of the results that I don't give you the proof of, the proof depends on an extension theorem due to Carathéodory that says if you've got something that's working as a measure on a decent collection of sets, then you can extend your measure to be defined on the whole sigma algebra that collection of sets generates. So he's got this brilliant way of boosting up measures defined on relatively few sets, like finite unions of intervals, and then extending it up to be defined on the sigma algebra they generate. And if you look at the signal out were generated by the intervals in the real line, you just get the Borel sets again. And so that's how that one works. Except that you can get a bit further. Carathéodory showed that the signal out you get is actually rather bigger than the Borel sets in this case. And so this is one of the ways of constructing the Lebesgue measure. It's not the only one. You can do it in dimensions, and in particular you can do it in dimensions 2 and 3, but we're going to concentrate on dimension 1. So as I say, we're not going to have time to do all the details, but you can find all the missing details. I will put some of the details on question sheets. The ones that I think it's reasonable for you to work out for yourself can go on question sheets for you to look at the details of those. Some of them are a bit more advanced, and there you're going to have to go and look in the books. I don't expect you to prove Carathéodory's extension theorem for yourself, so that's one you can look up and find out more about. You can look in Rudin's book on real complex analysis, that's got some good stuff in. You can look in my lecture notes online. Here's a link that can help you on that one. Now, there's more than one definition of a Lebesgue outer measure. We're going to do it based on half-open intervals, because that's the way I always used to do it when I was working, when I was teaching measured integration. So I'm going to try to be consistent with the way I did it in the measured integration module I taught before, so that if you do look back at those notes, the definitions you see will look familiar. But you can do this using open intervals or closed intervals or the other kind of half-open intervals, and it doesn't actually make any difference to the values you get. It's just a slightly different approach, which makes some bits make various bits of the construction easier than others. But since we're not going into full details, it's not really going to bother us very much. Okay, I want the notion, well, I want to look at a particular set of half-open intervals, and my half-open intervals are going to be open at the left end for our purposes. You can allow A equals B if you want. You have to treat the empty set as a special case. It doesn't actually affect anything, having the empty set in there. It makes some of the arguments easier if you've got it, other arguments easier if you haven't got it. Doesn't make any difference in the end, as usual. Length of the half-open interval is what you think the length of an interval is. B minus A, where the endpoints are A and B, with A less than B. Non-standard notation, I couldn't find, other than using Lebesgue measure, which would be a bit circular, I couldn't find an ideal standard notation for the length of an interval. You could use modulus, but that could be the number of points in a set. So I'll just call it length of the interval. So what is Lebesgue outer measure? Lambda star, called Lebesgue outer measure on R, is actually defined on all the subsets of R. So lambda star is actually a function from P of R taking values in the non-negative extended real line. And it's going to be the best we can do as a notion of the length of a set. Now I'm going to chop up the definition into bits, but I'll give you the full definition in one go at the end. And I'll explain what we're doing as we go. So what's going on? I'm using a bit of non-standard notation just to try and simplify things. If I start with my set E, a subset of the real line, whose total length we're going to try to measure. Now, E could be a very complicated subset of the real line. I mean, it could be the rationals, or it could be the irrationals, and even that's already enough to be worth thinking about, or it could be something much more complicated than the rationals or the irrationals. We're going to see some pretty weird ones, especially in the next section, when we get to the non-measurable set. But nevertheless, Lebesgue outer measure is going to attempt to measure the total length of any set. What does it do? It says, well, we know what we want the length of an interval to be. We've already decided that. And now we're going to estimate from the outside. So the idea is that we've got the real line. We've got our set E, so here's R. Here's our set E, which of course is much more complicated than this. And now we look at all the different ways you could cover E using a sequence of intervals in the real line. I've restricted attention to half open intervals, which are open at the, which side were they open? They're open at the right or at the left, I can't remember. Anyway, whichever half open intervals I went for, I'm going to look at ways of covering E using some sequence of these intervals. So, here are intervals IN. We've got a whole sequence of them, and they cover E. Well, we want to make sure that if you cover them, then there may be some overlaps. So you would hope that whatever the length of E is, it should be no more than the sum of the lengths of the IN. So we want that the length of E is less than or equal to the sum of the lengths of the INs, no matter how you choose to cover E with some intervals. So of course, what do? You look at all the different ways of covering E with intervals. And that's what's going on here. So you look at all the different ways of covering E with intervals from this particular collection S. And for every different one, you get a possible sum of lengths. So we look at all these possible sums of lengths. Now it may be, and this happens if E is a real line, if E is a whole of the real line, or some other unbounded interval, or something like that, it may well be that the sum of the lengths is always infinite. So there might be only one number in here. SE could be just a single point set, because no matter how you cover it, the value, the sum's always infinite. Or it could be there's lots of different ways to cover the set, and some of them have got infinite sum, and some of them have got finite sum, and so on. But no matter what you do, if you try to make this covering as efficient as possible, now you probably won't find a minimum best way to cover it. If you're working with the rational numbers, you won't find a perfect way to cover it with this kind of interval. All you can do is choose better and better ways to cover the rational numbers with sequences of intervals. These sequences of intervals never are single point sets, the ones I've chosen. Advantage of using closed sets is you can get single point sets. Advantage of using open intervals is that the things you're covering with are already open sets. Everything has its own advantages. We're using half open intervals, so you can't actually get one of those to be a single point set. So whenever you cover the rational numbers, you actually get a lot of redundancy in your cover. But you can make the redundancy have total length very small by using epsilon over 2 to the n or something like that for the length of your intervals. That's the sort of trick you do. So in fact, the total length of the rational numbers turns out to be 0, because by the time you look at all the possible sums of lengths you get here, the infimum turns out to be 0. So the general thing you do is you look at all the ways of covering it, usually lots of different ways of covering it, well, it's always lots of different ways of covering it. Among all those ways of covering it, you look at all the different different sums of lengths of the intervals you're using. That gives you lots of extended real numbers. You take the infimum to play the role of trying to get as an efficient cover as possible. Now, you won't achieve the infimum usually, as I've told you, you won't achieve the infimum if you're doing the rational numbers, but it's still playing the role of looking for an efficient cover, reducing the redundancy as much as you can, taking some sort of limit. Now, if you don't want to use any of the non-standard notation, you just have to write a longer definition. A lambda star of E is equal to the infimum of all possible sums from n equals 1 to infinity of bn minus an, where an and bn are sequences of real numbers with an less than bn for all n, and E is a subset of the union from n equals 1 to infinity of the half open intervals an, bn. It's quite interesting that you actually get the same number if you use any of the other kinds of intervals instead. You don't, by the time you take the infimum, you don't always get the same set, SE, by changing which kind of interval you look at, but the infimum is always the same. And that's, again, an exercise that I'll set you to look at. And if you want to go to higher dimensions, use area in R squared, volume in R cubed, do the obvious n-dimensional equivalent for hypercuboids in higher dimensions, and you can define Lebesgue out to measure in any dimension you like. And it sounds like we've done it. We've defined the length of every set in R, and we should be happy. The problem is, it isn't countably additive. It's not obvious that it isn't countably additive, and the proof of that requires the axiom of choice. But if you use the axiom of choice, as we're going to see in section 3.9, there are sets so bad that by the time you combine a sequence of disjoint sets, the lambda star lengths just don't add up right. Without the axiom of choice, that might not be true. So depending on how you feel about the axiom of choice, you might say, we're happy now, we've defined the length of every subset of the real line. But if you do believe in the axiom of choice, and it seems pretty harmless in the version we're going to use it, then you get some really horrible sets, as we're going to see when we look at the next section. Okay, we're out of time today, so next time I'll explain how you get from here to Lebesgue measure, and then we'll move on to this non-measurable set.